Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to another episode of The Booth. We're joined with the one and only, the main man, the guy that's been with us in many episodes, the Shaykh himself. Assalamu alaikum, how are you doing? You okay?
I'm good, brother. How are you, akhi?
Alhamdulillah.
It's good, mashallah. May Allah bless you, Jannah.
Ameen. The reason why I bring the Shaykh on is to help us with points of theology and Islamic law. The Shaykh has actually graduated from Medina. He's spent a lot of time in Egypt, and he's done his masters as well, things like that, in theology. So that's been his area of specialism for many years. We've used your expertise in many other things.
My master's
that we've
in
done.
Theology, by the way.
What is it?
I'm doing Rasul fiqh, inshallah.
Oh, you know, whatever.
Okay, principles of Jufa.
It's still related to theology, isn't it?
Alhamdulillah.
Fine. But we won't need that much expertise for what we're going to do today.
Subhanallah.
I brought you in to have fun today. So okay. Eat some popcorn.
Popcorn, yeah. Yeah. Jazakallah khair. Can I have some of that, inshallah?
Well.
I love this, Jannah. Barakallah khair. Bismillah.
No. And to watch, we're going to do a reaction video.
Okay.
This guy.
Yeah.
Sorry. This guy is one of the most vile individuals.
That's all I love.
Wallahi. I remember watching him when I was a young man.
May Allah save mankind from him.
Yeah, I mean, this guy, he's really like, he's a vile individual, honestly.
SubhanAllah.
He seems not to want to cooperate at all with the Muslim community. Mm-hmm. And he seems absolutely insistent on putting down Muslims and putting down Islam and having absolutely no integrity in doing so.
Central figure of hate to them.
Absolutely. And what I find absolutely shocking is that a man like this has been able to get such a following.
Okay. Shocking.
Because
it could be possibly for entertainment purposes.
It could be that's having husnul dhan, that's having a good opinion.
A good opinion, yeah.
But it could also be because there's this new ultra right, alternative right, political movement, and they just want to hear anything that's anti-Islam. Because it validates their worldview.
Anything and everything.
What we're gonna be doing is watching a video he entitled "It's Good to Be Anti-Islam."
Okay.
Very provocative title.
Yeah, absolutely.
It deserves a response.
Okay.
So let's inshallah, without further ado, just watch what he says, inshallah.
Before we start,
yes.
I think most likely, this is how my experience in these things is that these kind of people, unfortunately, they tend to literally, mention anything and everything. And everything they mention, most of the time, is false completely. And so I think what we'll possibly do is focus on the major things, the major points.
That's a good approach, and I'll tell you something else.
Rather than waste our time with everything.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. And I'll refer, if people watch his videos and stuff like that, I will tell you that almost everything he spoke about has been covered by us in separate videos.
Okay,
everything he's mentioned
good.
Has had its time in separate videos that we've done.
Great.
Okay? Because that's the thing we deal with. We deal with misconceptions of Islam. So almost everything that... So we're just going to touch upon a few things that he said, which are completely ridiculous. He's actually made a video anyways.
Okay.
And he's called it "What I Know About Islam."
Okay.
And he admits candidly, "I don't know anything. I don't know much about Islam."
But yet he hates a thing he's ignorant of.
Yeah, absolutely. Maybe it's to validate once again his worldview. But let's watch what he says.
I'm always amused when people accuse me of being anti-Islam, as if it's a bad thing, and as if I've been trying to hide it, and they've somehow caught me out. Aha! I see what you are now. You're just anti-Islam. Yes, well spotted, Sherlock. Indeed I am. Just like every other sane person on earth.
So what does that mean? If every other sane person on earth is anti-Islam, what does that make Muslims? And what does it make people that are pro-Islam?
Insane.
Insane. Yeah,
yeah, people have lost their intellect and as possibly their conscience. I mean, Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar.
So, I mean, the thing is this. I mean, imagine I said the same thing about homosexuals.
Wow. Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah,
if I imagine I said, or you said the same thing about gays.
Yeah.
Or Jews.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, those are the type of people he's going to be talking about in his video.
Yeah, okay.
So he shows intolerance to Muslims by insinuating that we're insane.
We're insane, yes. And right. Anyone who is pro-Islam in any way, shape or form
is insane.
Is automatically, by default, insane as well.
Okay, well.
Which is subhanAllah.
Why am I anti-Islam? Well, for the simple reason that Islam is anti-me, and it's anti every fundamental value I hold. If I were to accommodate its values in my life, I would have to violate everything that I believe in. I think that's an unreasonable demand. And as such, it is, of course, typically Islamic.
Okay, so straight away we can see here that a person, he's gone on the very premise, of course he's not a Muslim, clearly, yeah. But he's gone on the very premise that if anything is, you could say, divine, held in a yeah. special way to a certain person, then it's unreasonable to act upon them.
Yeah.
Whereas this premise is false. If we consider something to be divine, we consider Islam to be divine. Okay, we consider the scripture to be divine. Okay, yeah. We consider this to be the truth. Now, the values that we hold from this, what do we do with these values? You tell me.
Yeah, well, if something you believe in is automatically acted upon.
You right? act upon it, yeah. You accept it. Yeah. Okay, it's not contradictory to how you live your life or how you do things, because that premise that it's divine, that it comes from Allah, that it comes from God,
right.
is there.
Absolutely, I think you're absolutely right with that.
And likewise, that can be applied to anything else that you hold sacred or anything else that you hold to be of importance in your life, whether it's religion or non-religion.
He's got a complete egocentric view of morality. He's saying that if anything is antithetical to what I believe in, it's false.
Precisely.
So what if mathematics is antithetical to what you believe
then
in?
Then he will not believe
what
in.
What if science is antithetical to what you believe in? What if yeah. logical principles are antithetical absolutely. To what you believe absolutely. In? So that's not an argument. It's just, if anything, it's an emotional, egocentric argument,
yeah.
which has no currency whatsoever.
In general, I don't like to be anti anything. I prefer to be pro. But there's nothing in Islam to be pro about. The entire religion is built on a foundation of prejudice, injustice, and inhumanity, and I'm anti all of those.
So, what does it say? Prejudice, inhumanity?
Prejudice, injustice, and inhumanity.
Okay, no, let's see. What are the evidences for that?
For that, I think you don't find evidences against that.
Okay, give us some.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, Allah jalla wa ala talks about mankind.
What in what book do we
just look at the mystery of Allah subhanahu wa
ta'ala. So in for those who don't understand what we believe in, what book?
Look at the Quran, the final Quran. Revelation of right. Allah. This is the book of Islam.
So what does Islam say about justice?
O you who have iman. Instead of reading the Arabic, you read directly from English. Translate directly. O you who have brought faith,
yeah.
believe, kunu qawwamin bil qist. Be upright with justice. Be upright with justice. And this is something you find throughout the life of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that justice is a central theme. Justice is, you know, in fact, one of the names of Allah is the most just.
Is there some discussion on the validity of that name?
Let's not delve into this.
No.
But justice is a central theme in Islam. Okay?
Right.
Even if it is against a Muslim, it's irrelevant.
So if a Muslim...
In a court of law...
He's trying to insinuate that justice potentially has how we hold it
yes.
is only applicable to Muslims. So for example, what did the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say about correcting a Muslim being unjust?
Absolutely. Help your brother. Hmm. If he is unjust, then help him by advising him and correcting him and stopping his oppression.
If a Muslim is unjust towards a non-Muslim,
then you
do we acquiesce to that, or do we correct that?
We correct the injustice, even if it means taking him to the court of law.
And what's the evidence of this? Which is?
Give victory, literally give victory to your brother, whether he's an oppressor or being oppressed.
And
being
how do, oppressor, and how do you do,
as the companions asked, how do you do that?
Yeah.
By correcting him, stopping his oppression.
Wow. Even if it's against a non-Muslim?
Absolutely.
And is there any evidence of that in the life of the Prophet? Did he ever do that?
So you find this panel of many examples. Even the life, look at Ali radiallahu ta'ala,
yeah.
the fourth Khalifa, the fourth the leader
right, okay.
of the Muslims.
Yes.
There was a dispute over some of his a belonging
shield.
Of his, a shield.
Yeah.
And he was taken to the court of law.
Mm.
He took it to the court of law.
Mm.
Bear in mind, he is now the leader of the Muslims.
Yes.
But yet he had to take it to the court of law.
Mm-hmm.
And it was ruled against him
mm-hmm.
that, in fact, the shield did not belong to him. It belonged to the person, the claimant,
mm-hmm.
okay, or the defendant.
Yeah.
And that's justice.
And so that other person was not a Muslim?
He was not a Muslim. He was a non-Muslim.
Mm. So does the Quran instruct us to be unjust to non-Muslims?
Absolutely. To be just.
Yes.
Regardless.
And is there any evidence of the contrary?
None whatsoever.
I think we've refuted him.
Yeah, I mean, subhanAllah. What else was it? Injustice.
It's discrimination. And discrimination, I think he said also inhumanity.
Inhumanity. Look, one of the most famous verses of the Quran. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكِ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ I haven't sent you, O Messenger of Allah Muhammad, except as a mercy to mankind.
I think that would be enough. I think, hopefully, if anyone's got sincerity listening to what you're saying now, they'll accept this. They'll accept this.
People say, well, you only focus on the bad things about Islam. And yes, I have to admit that if you ignore the bad things, the aggressive separatism, supremacism, and social intolerance.
So once again, he's doing list of three.
Yeah, list of three. It's quite a common theme with him.
Yeah.
Yeah. What is that? What's that about list of three?
List of three is something, you know, you teach the GCSE kids to do. Okay. Rule of three, list of three. It's a good way to relay your point. But I don't think he's got a basic GCSE education on Islam. Having said that, let's see what he says. Aggressive separatism. Okay, so what about conviventia? What about the idea that you had Muslims, Christians, and Jews living harmoniously in Spain, even throughout the Ottoman Empire?
In Spain, in Jerusalem, in Palestine, in Saudi Arabia, even in the time of the Messenger of Allah himself, in Medina, which was the center of the Muslims, in Saudi Arabia, the Hijaz, outside of Saudi Arabia, in Syria, in the Byzantine Empire, in Iraq.
Does Islam tell us to, if for instance, if there's a country, say any country, any given country, right? We're saying, let's say Egypt is the Muslim country, there's 10% Copts in Egypt, 10% Christian, Coptic Christians in Egypt, yeah, of the population. Does Islam say, let's get rid of those Coptic, or force them to become Muslims, or is that some kind of misconception?
Absolutely. In fact, you find many resource textual evidence that point to the opposite of that. We cannot force. La ikraha fi din. There is no compulsion in religion.
Right.
If Muslims, for example, take over a country, for example, or whatever the case may be, you cannot force anyone to accept Islam.
That's right. Okay.
And in fact, if they accept some people, if they don't, then we live harmoniously with them. They have their rights as citizens. And no one can oppress them, no one can talk ill of them, no one can harm them, their wealth is secure, everything of them, their belongings, everything is secure.
And this is the Quran and Sunnah.
This is from the Quran, this is from the Sunnah, and this is from the Ummah itself. I mean, look, one of the strongest evidences to actually see how for the last 1400 years, how Muslims actually lived in their own lands. I mean, regardless, you don't even have to look at the Quran or the Sunnah. Right. You can see how the state conducted itself generally.
I see what you're saying. And I think what this man is exhibiting is actually the biggest of ironies, because he's talking about aggressive separatism.
But that's what he's doing now.
That's what he's doing.
His very being is clearly focused around this.
It's separatism, yeah. There you have it.
The relentless special pleading and phony grievance mongering, the psychopathic level of misogyny, the honor killing and genital mutilation.
Honor killings, is that in Islam?
Absolutely not.
Is there any evidence?
Absolutely, evidence against it. You cannot kill a life.
Give us one verse just to finish this guy off with that.
وَلَا تَقْتُلَ أَنفُسَكُمْ Do not kill yourselves.
Yes.
You cannot kill yourselves. You know, I mean, subhanAllah, just to be put on the spotlight, this is actually quite amazing. I mean...
And he's saying...
Your blood is safe.
That's cleared up.
In fact, one of the reasons why Islam came was to protect the blood of the people.
Right. So is there anything that says that? Mutilation.
There is not a single hadith, a single verse in the Quran that says we can allow genital mutilation.
That's it?
So I'm questioning his sources.
Well, he doesn't have any. He's not mentioning any sources.
Yeah, I doubt it.
The rabid gay and Jew hatred,
So the kind of hatred that he's displaying himself on Muslims.
Yeah.
Intimidation and censorship.
Censorship.
You know, I'm actually a bit worried about his mental health. I am, honestly. Man, I got it.
And the constantly present threat of violence over social issues, well, there isn't much wrong with Islam. It's perfectly kosher, if you'll pardon the expression. The trouble is, when you take...
Well. So you don't actually have to pardon anything. Okay.
When you take these things away, there's nothing left. There is no Islam anymore, because it is defined by these things, and we can see the evidence of this with our own eyes.
Does that mean we have debunked essentially most of his claims, and the rest of the ones that we haven't touched because they're irrelevant?
Yes.
It's absolute nonsense.
Yes.
Does that mean he would now retract this and say that actually Islam...
Yes.
Is
because no, because his understanding of Islam is that it consists of the things that he just said.
Absolutely.
So now we've proven the contrary. So what he should be doing now, if he's a fair person,
absolutely,
really and truly, if we don't even need to watch this video, we've done it now.
Yeah.
He says that's what Islam is.
Absolutely.
We've shown that Islam is not those things.
Islam is not those things.
So now that we've taught the man what Islam really is,
we invite him to Islam.
Pat Condell.
We invite you to eternal salvation. accept that there's none worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is the final messenger of Allah. I will enter into the religion of peace and tranquility, the religion of Islam.
On that bombshell, I will leave you and make sure you tune in to the next episode of The Booth. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you.